And in Croatia also they do something?
Not really, no. There aren't, the Jewish population isn't that strong, unfortunately.
It's not about the Jewish population, but about the Jewish history.
I mean, culture, yes. That's what it meant.
It's very important, the Jewish history in Croatia. I don't want to talk about those Croatian who, you know, who had, you see, who had the Nazis to kill the Jews there. Anyway, I'll start with something which my lady here, do you have the lecture of the four pages, please?
Yes, I will try to
hear. Can you give me, I want to read from here something, so
yes,
put it for me here,
yes,
the first page.
I need 2 minutes.
Two minutes, okay. So she needs 2 minutes. So I will start with this. About today is the 14th of...
No, the 20th.
Excuse me, you don't teach me the Jewish calendar.
Sorry.
I teach you. Can you show me the Jewish calendar? I just gave you one.
Yes.
Or you?
This
is the calendar.
Oh, well, it's in my computer.
This is the Jewish calendar, okay? The Czech Jewish calendar. One, yeah, everything is in Hebrew and in Czech. You see?
Mm-hmm.
You can read Czech, yes? And it's called Luach. Luach means calendar. Luach means also this, bowl. Okay? And what is written here? Odborni revize hebrejština. Michael Dushinsky, that's this gentleman. And you, where are you from?
Prague.
And born?
In Prague.
Real Prague? No, you're a mixture.
No,
parents?
But my family comes from a good family name. From
Balkan.
Yeah.
Where?
I'm not sure really.
Really, but originally, because you see a little bit darkish-like.
Yeah,
I know. There are Czech darkish also. Do you see? That's the Luach. It's beautiful. Yeah? That's the Luach. Yeah? Luach. Calendar. Okay? Okay? Odborni revize, Reština, Michael Dushinsky. And you are from?
I'm from Czech Republic.
But?
Oh, from Jamberg. It's really small town.
Where?
It's close to
Pardubice. Pardubice. Okay, closer. Going closer to... Last night we had the Philharmonic of Pardubice in a concert here in Prague. Yeah, yeah. The symphony orchestra. Okay. Oh, okay. So now I want to start with this. Before I leave, so you don't look up there, just look at me. This is Shofar. So about a month ago, on the 10th of Tishrei, which was according to the non-Jewish calendar, I will not kill it, but I want to kill it, in the 10th of Tishrei, 10 days after the starting of the Jewish year, Tishrei is the name of the month, by doing Arabic, also Tishrin, you have some months which are, but it's not the same. The only thing which is the same in the Muslim that we are going, the months are according to the cycle of the moon. So we have the same month, but not the same year. Okay? But that's not now, that's not our lecture. So Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, was on the 16th of September. And now we are only 20th, so it's about a month. Just in the end of the festival, I did this. Oh, I hope it will work. Yeah. Calendar, which is Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, which is the 10th day after Rosh Hashanah, the beginning of the year. And in the end of the lecture, if we have time, I will speak about a little bit about the music which we sing, because Yom Kippur, we are all day, 25 hours in the synagogue, from the night before, because the Jewish datum, the Jewish date, the Jewish day starts in the evening before, and not at 12 o'clock, arbitrarily, no astronomic reason for that. So we start in the evening, as it is written in the Torah, in the beginning of the creation, and there was evening, and there was morning, one day. which means the day starts in the evening, not in the morning. But that's just a little thing for you. I hope you remember it. If not, you'll ask him to send you the lecture. I tried this little one, which went all the way. It went through Europe, through the Holocaust, to America, and from America came back here. I started to cry whenever I mentioned this word. I'm sorry. We were sitting yesterday, he and I, in a place. You can write this name to you, Helga Oshkova. They write this name. Some of you may be here. She's a great artist. She's 92. And she was in Terezin as a little child. This is where she started to draw, to paint, and she survived most of her friends. No. Anyone wants to try? Because of Corona, a little bit of problem, but you want to try?
No.
And one of the girls?
No.
No one? Let's leave it. Maybe in the end.
Maybe we should say that this is actually not a musical instrument because it is a piece of animal, so it's not treated as a musical instrument, and that's why it has this. There is this exception for shofar.
You wanted a lecture about
yes.
Jewish music, so I started with the not voice music,
yes,
which is
yes,
good.
Yes, yes,
yes. I also have this, but this
we already, it's just that we already heard that in the traditional setting, Orthodox Ashkenazi setting, we don't use musical instruments.
No, we
for
don't.
During the
but
service.
There is not any connection between musical instrument and this. This is already
yeah.
written
yeah.
in the old books
exactly.
of Moses.
Yeah.
You know, the five books of Moses, the beginning of the Bible. And in these five books of Moses, it's written that this day, Rosh Hashanah, will be a day of blowing. And according to tradition, we are blowing this. When was the temple in Jerusalem? So it was not only this, but it was also with a big orchestra. With trumpet. We invented the orchestras. We invented symphony. The Jews. Yeah, of course, the Italians took it from us. You know, when Roma destroyed, when they destroyed the temple in the year 70, Titus, when he destroyed the temple, so he took with him everything, including the music. You can see it in the Titus Gate in Roma. If you go to Rome, G, you say, no? You go to Rome, there is a Titus Gate. If you go to Titus Gate, you will see all the trumpets and all the things. You see them with the menorah, which means that they took the music with them, and then they said, everything is allegro, adagio, papa. It's all coming from us. They stole the music from us. By the way, the word symphony is written in the Tanakh, in the Bible. In our Bible, which means when I say Bible.
The Greek word?
Yeah.
The Greek word?
So what?
Yeah.
We are using Egyptian words? This is the Jewish Bible, and the Jewish Bible, it's in Hebrew, only in Hebrew, you see, I didn't bring the English translation, and this has only 24 books. It does not include anything of the, it's called the New Testament. We don't know about any New Testament. We have only one Testament, okay? And this is our Testament and our Bible. This is Tanakh. So, now I'm starting my lecture by reading the introduction here with you. And I really mean every word which I said 8 years ago. And that was not the first time that this lady, good day ladies and gentlemen, our sages in Talmud bid us to start by honoring the host. I wish to express my big thanks and appreciation to, she's not magister anymore, you see, Dr. K. Veronica Seidlova, and the Institute of Ethnomusicology, which does not exist anymore also, I think, or partly maybe, because you are not in this course, you are in a different kind of department, in the university. But that was Charles University. Veronica found out some years ago, so it's going back like 15 or more, almost 20 years ago, that there has been here in Prague one Jew who happens to be an Israeli, a lecturer and a rabbi, a teacher of synagogue singing, and who was also in love with music, general music. She managed to dedicate from her holy time, because every minute of her is really holy, among tons of other duties, that still remains, correct? To initiate and to organize in the shortest notice, exactly this time also, a pure, original Jewish traditional lecture for you. I suppose that she was able to do, to so do, wow, what a beautiful English, due to her love of music, her intellect, and her open-mindedness, which helps her in all fields of her profession. We are now in the most magnificent town in the world, and I'm going to speak about and sing synagogue music. I'm thrilled because I remember all the Jews who lived in about 400 congregations here in Bohemia and Moravia, a vivid Jewish religious life before Shoah and Holocaust and before communist era. I humbly feel like representing more than 6 million, a third of our people who were murdered in Shoah Holocaust. In a small town in Moravia, Koyetin, there are some mistakes, or as the Jews called it, Goitain, some 220 years ago, my ancestor, forefather, the famous Rabbi Baruch Benedict Goitain, was born. About 100 years ago, my great uncle, Rabbi Koppel Dushinsky, served as Rabbi of Jewish community in Kostel, which is now called Podivin, also in Moravia. Now you understand why I love the Moravians so much. My wife is also from there, doesn't matter now. On both, you may read in Encyclopedia Judaica. That's it. So that was the introduction. You can put it off. Maybe not, because according to the plan, I have to look on the telephone. What was the plan? Where do we start? What we start? So we started with the shofar. That was another surprise. One surprise. And the other surprise will be Veronica Seidlova. So she wrote to me like this. Number one, when we made the meeting, please kindly bring short lecture about Te'amim, Megillat Esther, chanting psalms, Nusa for Yom Kippur, shofar. So you see, I started with the shofar. This is called shofar. May I? Okay. And now, you see, can I use something like that? So let's write the word. Why did I talk about that? Can you give me a
Black or what?
Blue. Oh yeah, there is one here. Okay, good, thank you. So look, no, it's okay. I give you a little lecture in grammar. Okay? You understand what they wrote here? This is where you study. Yeah? College University. What is your main topic? Your major?
English and
Arabic.
History.
Philosophy and anthropology. Philosophy.
And archaeology?
Anthropology.
Anthropology.
Yeah, same with me. Anthropology.
Philosophy
and
anthropology. Philosophy and anthropology.
Anthropology also.
And?
Also.
Anthropology only?
Yeah.
No philosophy. Okay, so you come to university to study this, but I said these are called syllables. In Czech, slabičky. Slabiki, sorry. How? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 slabikis we have. And according to the stress on the syllable, we know which language, which country you come from. If you hear somebody says Universita, you know he's from Russia or Poland, correct? Universita, correct? If you say Università, French, Italiano, yeah? Last syllable. If you say University, it's American. English. But if you say university, no language says it on the fourth syllable. But if you say universita, you are Czech. Correct?
Yeah.
So let's try it. Say this, all of you.
Universita.
Now this one, it does not exist. Maybe, I don't know, Chinese. Uni.
Uni.
And now, Uni.
Universita.
In Israel we say Universita. Why? Because maybe we learned it from the English people. They hold us for 30 years. From 18 to 1917 to 1948. I was born in the British time. I have a British Palestinian passport of my father. Universita, you know. Yeah?
Universita.
And?
Universita.
Fantastic, isn't it? How is it in Spain?
Universidad.
Universidad, yeah. Yeah, that's Spain, you see? Okay, it's on this. Yeah? Isn't it great? So this is what, so when you write a word, you don't know how to pronounce it. If you don't pronounce it properly, according to the stress on the right syllable, you don't speak your language. So how do you know that it's universita? So you must put the stress. This is one of the reasons for these little signs. You see little signs here? All kinds of signs. You see? All kinds of signs. This is the letters, and these are all kinds of different signs. You see? Millions of signs. She knows them already. She's learning them. She never stops to study. Yeah, really. And this is unbelievable. So, but the vowels you have, so you don't have a problem. This is vowel U, E, A, E, A, A. That's no problem for you because you have the vowels inside the word. We don't. We have only consonants. Consonants? So,
Solaski.
No? The other one? The
vowel?
Samolaski. No Samolaski, only Solaski. Terrible. So when I want to read...
You write, but you have it, you say it.
What?
The Samolaski, you pronounce vowels, you pronounce it with vowels. You just write it without vowels.
Yeah, no. When we write something, can you imagine? Some of these books in the Bible were written for almost 4,000 years ago. Minimum 3,000 years. Time of Moses and all this. So how do we know how to read them? This book was written only around the year like 500 BCE, like 2,500 years ago only, something like that. And this is called the Book of Esther. It's part of the Bible. You have the many Czech ladies have the name Esther. You have read the Book of Esther? Yes or no?
No.
It's not such a long one, you see, that's all. It's not such a big deal. You can read it in Czech, in your Bible. It's a beautiful story, it's a meshuga, it's a madness story. But it's about somebody who wanted to kill all the Jews and God saved them. You know, somebody asked a Jewish joke. What about the Jewish festivals? Oh, somebody wanted to kill all the Jews and God saved us and we eat and we drink. That's more or less the same, yeah? So here you have the same text which you saw before without any of the signs. You see? Just the letters. And the letters are only consonants. Terrible. How should I know if it's universita or anuvasite? How do I know? There's no vowels. And no stress and things like that. So this is the role, these are the roles of the teamim and of the dots. So the dots, which are there, the first apparat is the dots. The dots are telling us the vowels. The vowels, or sometimes the doubling of the letter to make it strong, doesn't matter. But these are the dots, mainly for the vowels. But that was not enough, because in Hebrew, if you say ba'a, ba'a, say please.
Ba'a.
That means she comes. Say ba'a. She comes.
Ba'a.
On the first syllable, she came.
She came.
What's the big difference? Yeah. But you know, if you learn Chinese, you also have to learn also to play with your voice. Up and down can change the world. So that we have also in Hebrew. Ratza. She ran. Ratza. She is running. Yeah? Ratza. Ratza. Say. Ratza.
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 So they know something about stress. Good. So I will read. So when I have to read this every week from the Torah, this is not the Torah, this is a later book, but I just showed you that it's written on parchment. Can you move it between the people and look at it? And so this is the Megillah. Megillah means scroll, and you see it. Can you explain to me what this parchment, this cloth, which is made from the skin of... No? And in the end, there is a very famous, if you look in the illustrated Bible, you have the 10 sons of Haman, this bad guy who wanted to kill all the Jews, and here they are all hanged on the tree. You see, all 10 of them. You see, it's really like... Hang on the tree. We hang all these people who wanted to kill us. The only, after, I don't know how much you know, but the word Nuremberg trials after the Second World War, and there were a few people who were hanged on Purim, on the same festival. And one of these Nazis said, the Jews are now happy when they are hanging me, because he knew about the Jewish calendar, you know, after he himself, who knows how many. I cannot continue the sentence. So this is it, okay? Go and show it to them. By the way, when we read the Torah, it's going like this, with some things to hold it, because the Torah is 5 books of one, it's quite big. And very ceremoniously, we take it out from the Ark, the Holy Ark in the synagogue, and we put it back and so on, and we read. And every week, somebody must prepare 100, more or less, new verses. According to the dots, it will read Ba'a and not Ba'a, yeah? According to the, according Ba'a and not Bu'u or Be, because there are no dots, yeah? No vowels. Then Ba'a, Ba'a. And then, which one word is connected to the next one and which is separated, like, you know, commas and things like that, which you have nowadays. We have for each word a role in the sentence, in the verse. And the main thing is, and here comes the musicality, also he has to read it with music. So this is hard work every week. Some people are making money. I just told him that I remember a young man, he used to go to 3 different synagogues to read for them the Torah, because no one in the people who come to pray there every Shabbat morning, 200 people, no one wants to sit on his, how do you call this? You know, on his bum, and to sit and prepare, because when he comes to the text, he has to know what is in the one, the dotted one. You understand? Because in the holy book itself, there is nothing. Bakasha. So now moving. That's upside down. And we are reading from right to left, yes? Okay? So, now I will do only a few examples of the music for you. And then we will continue to the next subject. So, let me read this little thing for you. Okay? You don't have enough of that. Oh, you gave it to me. So let's see. The lecture is based on the lecturer's personal experience, okay, of the scripture of Tanakh. Tanakh means Torah, Nevi'im, and Ketuvim. These are the 3 parts of our Bible, according to Ta'amei HaMikra, the cantillation and accentuation symbols. The tradition is ascribed in the Talmud to as earliest as King Solomon, which goes back to 1000 BCE, 3000 years. The Teamim were designed to help keeping the tradition of the public reading of the Tanakh, and they are grant us with instructions for right stress on the syllable in a word, which we already demonstrated, the conjunction and separation of words in a verse, and the musicality of the lectionaries and how do you read it. The Tiberian system, 6-7 CE, was invented quite late, I mean the marking of them, but traditionally the way to read them were even before, but only by heart, you know, not by writing. The writing symbols, there were a few of them, but the one which took over has been accepted by all Jews since the 9th or 10th century, which is not so, in our history, it's very, very late. Yeah? The Ashkenazic melodies are demonstrated in the tape, but there is no tape. There is, yeah, that's in the old days, there was tape. In my car, I have a tape player. Do you know what is tape? You remember the old tape? I have a CD player and a tape player, yeah, in my old car. Yeah. Torah, now, the principal division chanting the same marks. As you saw, there are marks, as I showed you before in the text. And there are different ways. Look, one is the Torah on weekdays, on Shabbat festivals. One is Torah on the high holidays, which is, we just mentioned, the beginning of Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. One is for the prophets, number three. And the Ketuvim, the writings, have three different ones. Shir HaShirim, Rut and Kohelet, Song of Song, Eicha and Esther. So let me just go up and, yeah, I should start with the Bereshit, the beginning. Bereshit bara Elohim. This is the Eastern Jewish, Poland, Lithuania, Western Jewish, Ashkenazi. Bereshit bara Elohim. Both of them are okay. But you see, Bereshit, in the beginning, bara created God. Not Mr. in the beginning created God. Problem, yeah? But this is the order of words in the Hebrew. In the beginning, God created. So there is a little in the beginning. What happened in the beginning? Logic. God created. So the word God created will be with ta'am, te'amim, plural, connecting one. One connecting, one stopping. And in the beginning will be also. So Bereshit, bara Elohim. You see, bara was connected to the next one. Yeah? Are you okay with me now? Bereshit, bara Elohim. All of you. Bereshit. Hello, ethnomusicology.
Bereshit
bara Elohim,
bara Elohim
et hashamayim,
et hashamayim
ve'et haaretz,
ve'et haaretz.
Beautiful. Now you can go to the synagogue next Shabbos. Shalom. Bye bye. Okay. Beautiful. Okay. And then this is on Shabbat. Yeah, but let's do the Zachor. This is the Shabbat before Purim. You remember Purim? We read this Megillah. We read this Megillah.
Here.
There. Okay. Megillah, the scroll of Esther, and everyone is really. It's like a festival. People are coming to the synagogue dressed in all kinds of things, like a Venezia. How do you call it?
Carnival.
Yeah, carnival, like, yeah? Dressed beautifully in different things, and then they continue to celebrate after the reading, all night, drinking, and Shabbat before, we're reading from the Torah, a little piece, which is telling about the story when we went out of Egypt, that was really more than 3,000 years ago. And Moses, let my people go. You heard this song once in your life? I don't know. Oh, Moses, the slaves in America, sorry, in North America. He's always close to America because he's from Colombia, and that's not fair. This is America for him. This is North America, yeah? United States, Canada, Mexico, that's North. But he is from America. Don't call it South America. Nahon?
Nahon.
Yes, yeah, Nahon means true, Pravda. So he's, so in North America, the slave, the black slave, used to sing this song. They took it from the Bible because they were all very Bible people. So they say, when Moses, Moses came to Pharaoh and said to him, let my people go, let my people go. Okay, so when we went out from Egypt with many miracles and God crossed, opened the sea for us and so on, the first people who came to try to kill us, and they did, some of us, were some tribe who was there in the desert, somewhere in Sinai, I don't know, and it was called Amalek. And we had to fight against him, and we finished with him, and God gave us a big mitzvah. Zachor at asher asa lecha Amalek. Remember what Amalek did unto thee, unto you. By the way, when you, ye means you in plural, in Old English, Shakespearean English, you know, some of you do Shakespeare, were come forth out of Egypt. Were come forth, beautiful English, get out of Egypt. How we... He met you, by the way, and smote the hindmost of you, even all that were feeble behind you, when you was faint and weary, and he feared not God, and he did not fear God. So we read this pasuk in Hebrew. Zachor, asher asa lecha Amalek, baderech. This is when we read it on Shabbat, Western European, or Zachor, asher asa lecha Amalek baderech betzetchem mimitzrayim. Who made this? Malvan, according to Rabbits. You know, they took the music of the traditional, sometimes quite boring, because you have to read 100 verses and people are sitting, chatting, not allowed to chat, all the time, shh. And then you have to be very careful to follow what he says, and when he's not reading properly, everyone shout, ba, yeah. Yeah. So this is not always so pleasant for the one who reads, you know, that somebody, or in our community, there is a tradition here in Prague that there is someone here who makes him with the hands signs how to read the proper music. Yeah, yeah. And you know, on the last Shabbos, I was the reader. And I wanted to bring somebody. So the rabbi, Czech guy who was brought up here, Rabbi David Petter, the chief rabbi of Prague, you can invite him to a lecture, he will be grateful then, I think. And he said, you must have the one who knows how to do our traditional signs. I said, but I'm not, I'm from Tel Aviv, I don't know your tradition. Although I lived 20 years, I still did not get to their signs. Because every community had their own signs to the one who helps the reader, who did not prepare properly. So I told him, I don't need, I prefer properly. I only need from time to time somebody to remind me when is the end of a verse or something like that. Said, no, this is our tradition. Do you know how to do it? He said, yes, yes, I know. Yeah, it was terrible, you know, tradition is very important. And but this is a true story from just last year. Usually I'm not the reader because I'm not doing it for free. If they want me to sit on my, you say it in Yiddish, tuches. Can you say tuches? Tuches, yeah. You sit on my tuches and prepare 100 verses to be perfect without signs and without helping. You know, it's like preparing for, I think, opera. 100 things without... You don't have the text with you when you sing the opera. Or somebody... Yeah, there was this little one there sometimes telling you what to say. But, you know, when you sing, you have to prepare. But you don't repeat every day the same opera. You have to learn another opera every week. 100 verses, it's half opera, no? More or less, I don't know, maybe more, I don't know. And people don't think about it. Anyway, now we try to do Zachor in the mu. If the Zachor was not in the Torah, but in the prophets, the music, the mode of the music, and here comes your musicality, the mode of the music is going to be very different with the same signs. Okay, so I do the Hebrew, the Torah first, then the prophets, okay? The Torah. Zachor, asher asa lecha, amalei, baderech, betzitchem, b'mitzrayim. Now I do the same verse in the music of the prophets. Zachor, asher asa lecha, amalek, baderech, betzitchem, b'mitzrayim. Totally different. Different mode. And if you don't do this, don't go up. Yeah? And then, there is the third one, what was it? You tell me. Torah, oh no, the second one, Torah on Yamin Noraim. Yeah? Torah, if it was part of the reading of the High Holidays, this Zachor, it would be like this. Zachor, אשר עשה לך עמלי בדרך בצדכם ממצרים. Wow, beautiful, very uplifting, this one, because it's the holidays of the year. Beautiful. But it's very different from the first and the second one. And then you come to the third one we did, the prophets. Then the fourth one. Da-da-dee-da-da-dee-da-dee-da-dee-da-dee-da-dee-da-dee-da-dee-da-dee-da-dee-da-dee-da-dee-da. Zachor, asher asa lecha, amalek, baderech betzedchem ממצרים. Song of song. Shira shirim asher lishlomo, song of love. Ishakei mi min shikot pihu. You really feel how he's coming to kiss me. Ki tovim dodecha b'yayim. Lereach shemanecha tovim shemen torak shemen. Totally different one, yeah? This is what we read on the Song of Songs. Eicha, I don't like it. Because this is Lamentations. Lamentations means... check.
No, nashek.
Pla, pla.
Plach.
Plach, see? Plach, and the plach is very, very sad music. And then come Esther. Esther is the most happiest one, yeah? So it's the same key of the Echa, because it's just the opposite of the plunge, of the lamentation, but in a quicker and in a little bit. It will be like this. ויהי בימיך אשר זכור את אשר עשה לך עמלק בדרך בצאתכם ממצרים אשר ככה בדרך ויזנב בך המכשולים אחריך ואתה עייף ויגע. And if it was lamentations, ואתה עייף ויגע ולא ירא אלוהים. And you start to cry. And that's it. So now we made the lecture about the Ta'amim. I think you got the idea. And we can go to the next subject. So, yes.
Do you have some questions?
Yeah, please.
The principle that you have the same signs.
but you have to intone them differently according to the type of the scripture.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it's very interesting. So if you want to read more about it, there is some paper about it, mm-hmm. which you, this one is also published in the musicology department.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
Musica Judaica. Musica Judaica, you can find it there. So maybe now it's already on the internet. It's my lecture, which I give in some conference. I give this lecture in many conferences. You know, it's very good when you are becoming academics and you have one good lecture. So you can celebrate with it from Sweden to Australia and all in between.
I really mean it. Not anymore.
Huh?
Not anymore.
Why? Because of?
Because at every conference now you have to present some new research.
Yeah, but if they, but I asked once, I come, can you use the same lecture in two different conferences? They said, yes, because those people never heard it, so why not? That's Dr. Budki told me, Watson Budki, millions of years ago.
It used to be like this.
Yeah, no, but it depends what is the subject of the conference.
Sure.
I'm not talking about publications, of course. But my own publication, which is anyway, but it's very